Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever and whenever you're watching this. Welcome to our spring virtual lecture series here at SCI-Arc, here in a very fluid way these days. It is my pleasure and my honor to introduce Tatiana Bilbao, our speaker tonight. Tatiana is a remarkable architect for many reasons that I'll try to address as much as I can in a brief introduction so everybody get to listen and to enjoy Tatiana's work and Tatiana's thinking. As I said, she's a remarkable architect in a country and a city with remarkable architecture culture. So she has many hats, I would say. She operates in many levels. She touches many aspects of what it means to be an architect. So some example, early in her career, she worked as an advisor for urban projects for the Urban Housing and Development Department of the City of Mexico. At that time, she also worked as an advisor for what it would be the Secretary for Urban Development and Housing of the government, the what it was at that time known as Mexico Distrito Federal. So that's a very remarkable way to start the career. So it means that she's been in and out of the beast, what it means to deal with problems of this scale. And of course, she's based in Mexico, but her practice is a global practice. She has projects in many countries, China, France, United States, Guatemala, to name among many, many ones. She also has been the recipient of many awards, some of the more remarkable, the Global Award for Sustainable Architecture Prize from the Locos Foundation and the Cité l'Architecture in Paris. She also received the A+A Awards Impact Award for her groundbreaking work in social housing sustainable design. And recently in 2019, she received the Marcus Prize among many other prizes. She is a teacher and she's been teaching Rice University, Columbia University, Yale, Harvard, Architectural Association. Her work has been part of the recipient of solo shows and participating in Biennales and all the other things, which of course she is a remarkable figure in the field and she has a remarkable career. But honestly, what I want to focus more in my introduction is I think Tatiana is at the center, which I think is a crucial discussion for us architects in these times, in the COVID world that we live in and the COVID world that is coming after, in the world of social inequality that we are confronted on a regular basis in the United States, but all over the world. And her work is at the intersection between all these things and the power and the ability of design to be an agent for change, how we deal with the problem of social housing and social issues with a high quality of design and not to present it as more often than not happens as dichotomies or things that they are different elements. And also she has another extraordinary, which is how she blends the tradition of the culture of Mexico in innovative and pushing to the future, focusing a lot in what are the possibilities of groundbreaking and speculation and innovation. So, as I said, her work and her way of thinking has multiple angles, and that's what I think it makes her such an important voice for us to hear in this time right now. So, without further ado, please join me to welcome Tatiana Bilbao to the SCI-Arc Virtual Lecture Series. So, Tatiana, it's a pleasure to have you with us. And the Zoom screen is all yours.
Thank you, Hernán. Thank you very much for the very nice introduction. I'm really, really pleased to be here with you in this digital world. And with no further to say, I will share my screen and start right away. Thank you. 4 years ago, I had the first conversation with Father Killian, the leader for a project of a new monastery to be built in Germany in the near future.
Buenos días. Oigan, vamos a vestirnos primero, ¿no? Buenos días, María.
Hola, señora, buenos días.
¿Qué hago más pera?
¿Te hago su licuado?
Sí, por favor.
Yo quiero más pera, yo quiero más pera, yo quiero más pera.
Ok, ahorita te hago su
licuado. Yo quiero más pera.
¿Te quieres?
Mío.
Hay que coser.
Working for this monastery has been instrumental in shaping the way I think and what I do. At the end, the monastery is not the only architectural topology with form follows function. It's the ultimate domestic space. The understanding of the physical configuration of a monastery has allowed me to understand the importance of this the scale in relationships.
Termina de tu sándwich.
Mami. Quiero algo dulce.
¿Quieres un nariz? Tú le te la di, mi amor.
Mari, ¿me puedes pasar?
Mami, quiero algo dulce.
Ok, come algo.
¿Dónde?
Me la como.
No.
Allá.
Entonces.
No.
Esta.
Este es el corazón y la semilla.
¿Cómo vas?
Niñitas.
Not only the importance of silence, but of rituals in life.
Gloria patri et filii.
Working in, for these Cistercian monks has allowed me to understand probably a world that I know too well, but something that I hadn't reflected too deeply, and that's the domestic realm. Heiligkreuz is the longest inhabited monastery in Europe. It's a Cistercian monastery. It was founded in 1133. And this is the mother house of the new monastery, the new house that it's going to open its doors in around 5 years in Neuzelle in Germany. So far, we have done a deep research on the typology, which is, as I said before, one of the only programs that I have seen that where form follows function, and not only that. Function follows form in an intrinsic way that it's totally linked with not only the space, but the rhythm and the life of the inhabitants itself. It is, and we don't know what happened first, but it works as exactly the rhythm of their day works. It's very interesting and probably one of the most compelling things is the understanding of this procession through the space and the procession through the day that has really allowed me to understand the importance and the necessity of really understanding how we could integrate those elements in our everyday life and what are the things that could improve that. So far, we have been working very long to understand the program, the possibilities of the site, all the legal aspects of it, in order to secure the site for the monks, and we have started to lay down some conceptual ideas. But I think that the understanding that we have created, the knowledge behind it, has really allowed us to define all the interest in the office right now, and this is why I wanted to start with this. For me, the most key aspects of what I have understood these past 4 years is the possibility, or the not the possibility in this case, is the necessity, but a possibility for maybe us mundane people, of the understanding of the necessity of scaling the spaces and the types of relationships within the body and the space, and the space and the rest of the inhabitants in the space, and then again back to the body. And I think that when I understood how the monks really have this necessity of having these protective layers, that they don't see them only as protective layers to their ritual, to their life, to their spiritual life. They also see them as expressions, as holders, as expressions, as possibilitators of their spiritual life. It's until I understood really the importance of the constitution of their space. And for them, their spirituality is in their body, in their souls, which is embodied with their body. And the first exterior expression of that is the robe. For that, the importance of the robe, the importance of the specific design of the robe that expresses and protects the body, but then first is the first that expression to the exterior. Then the cell that becomes this space for the moment where the monk can really be with itself, with its own spirituality, and be able to reconstitute itself for it. when they go out from the cell, you encounter the cloister, and the cloister is the place where all the monks in the community are in a space of procession towards their other activities. And this is the next set of relationships. When they enter through the cloister to the church, this is the place in the church where they encounter the community that holds together the monastery, that is not only formed by the monks, but also it becomes that anchor, that it's kind of the relationship with the community at large in the exterior of the monastery. So I think that this possibility of a scaling of relationships has allowed me to understand the importance of that to create a much more sustainable and a social possibility of relationship between each other, between us, that would really, I believe, transform the way we possibly build. And on the other hand, I have understood also that we could also start to question all those set of standards that we have allowed to arrive to this point where we can create these possibilities of scaled relationships between human beings that would allow us to have a platform for us for a different future. And this is something that I have always questions in cities, no? In cities we are, and I was glad that Hernán was saying about these dichotomies. I am really scared that more and more we live in binaries in this moment in the world. And those binaries are absolutely discriminating the majority of the people, no? And in cities, the problem of the binary between the private and the public, I think has been really posing an important limit for us to create important networks of relationships that would allow us to become more sustainable in terms of our holding our own lives. In an aim of thinking that we need to go and search for a possibility of an understanding of a social economy that would allow us to really put in the center of it the possibility of care and reproduction, and therefore to hold on our existence, to become then productive human beings. I know architecture can do all, but I think that architecture has become this impediment to the possibility of transformation as well. No, not that without transforming the way we do architecture, things cannot change, or neither the other way around. If we change architecture, things will change. But I believe that we could be part of it if we really decide to question a lot of the things that normally the majority of us architects, me myself included, I declare myself guilty, take for granted and just don't think the implications that they do. For example, the configuration of the house, and why I will explain why. And while I also have tried to create possibilities for opening channels for more people to accede to decent place of living, or what I thought it was, I have now understood through these 4 years that I have been immersed in myself in trying to search for something different using the same formulas, but not only that, not questioning deeply the true values that what I was doing is pursuing, no? And I believe that by also doing that, I am also guilty of not being able to produce something that really even creates a more sustainable relationship with the environment that we live in. So I think that by understanding, no, the impossibilities in the moment where we are living, we could really think on the possibilities of creating platforms to overcome some of the issues, no? But more and more, and I would say I would be very true, for me to become more honest on what I do, because through all my career, I have been pursuing the possibility or the idea of building not with the other, but being the other. And in truth, first of all, that's impossible. And second of all, it will never happen. So what I've been thinking, transforming that into the possibility of creating a platform where the other really becomes represented. It becomes represented by itself, not by me, not by anyone else. I don't have that power, but by itself. And we all know, no, the house is a fundamental architectural component that is structure our everyday life and defines the relationship with our bodies and with other people. But the house continuously remains a contested space, the contemporary environments are highly commoditized, no, and are shaped around preconceptions. Unfortunately, many of these preconceptions are turned now into built now in the local codes and administrative norms worldwide. In Mexico, a dignified and enjoyable place to live is a constitutional right. While it's not the case everywhere in the world, the right to living space has become a law that precisely defines what the space is. In many cases, that dignified and enjoyable and affordable space is defined by quantitative aspects rather than qualitative aspects. No, a house, a unit, an apartment are defined by minimums, minimum square footage, minimum amount of light, minimum ventilation, and a conventional composition of spaces, 2 bedrooms, 1 bathroom, 1 living area, 1 kitchen. In some cases, the law goes as far as to direct where the bed should be placed against a window. Obviously, these objectively seem laws, which are drafted to ensure safe and healthy living environments, reinforce conventional standards, and discriminative domestic environments. And I'm going to tell you why. We have been really trying, no, architectural practitioners, theorists, and have dedicated more than a century to pursue solutions, collective solutions, that would provide with the minimal optimal conditions for living. And in the best of the cases, these minimal optimal conditions becomes the maximum. And the entirety of their homes is dependent on these minimums for those, and those are the so-called living solutions. But as a society, we're really far from achieving a solution to the question of housing. In the present condition, the majority of the population do not have what is described in the codes as a decent place to live, let alone an enjoyable one. Let's assume that we are clever enough and we are able to magically find the formula that would allow us to achieve what we have long been pursuing, no? What the law and codes in the world define as a dignified and enjoyable housing for each household in the world. Is that really the place where we can take care of ourselves? Are we really tackling the correct question? Let me start to explain how I see the relationship of the body and the house. Let's think that we are really addressing the necessity of our body in the space that protects us. Would then, don't you think we would question a little bit the configuration of the house? Right now, the house as it is really pursuing more precisely to say it's perpetuating the idea that you have to live as a nuclear family. That minimum dwelling defined in the majority of the codes, but at least in the Mexican constitution is, that then has been transcribed as a law, defines as a house needs to be 2 bedrooms, 1 bedroom needs to be double bedroom, another smaller bedroom, 1 bathroom, 1 kitchen, 1 living space. That space only fits 20% of the population in the world. This space will limit 76% of the population to live the way they truly live. And in the other hand, is allowing the system to perpetuate the discriminative aspect of the house itself. And I will explain you why. I'm asking myself to see the house and to think the importance of every space in the house and what is its configuration is that it's perpetuating the system of discrimination and it's not allowing us to move into a different direction. I would say that the room is that space where we are able to reconstitute ourselves. No, it's a place, a room, any room. It's the place where we really find our most intimate acts with ourselves, with our interiority. And this space needs to be a very protected, respected space that would allow us to reconstitute ourselves. But not all of us do it the same. So how can we think to create a space that would allow us to do that, but allow us to include ourselves, to be ourselves? Some of us will like to have it as a space that represents us. Some of us will have it to space as retreat. Some of us to share with the most intimate person that you share your life. And some others would really definitely like it only as a cell, as a monk. What about the bathroom? I mean, the bathroom, we all agree that it's incredibly necessary that we all have a functional, clean space to use. But really, do we need these boxes? Can't we think of the bathroom, of this place, of our first possibility of the intimate interaction among ourselves with our own body, but also our own body with other bodies. This place where the family could share their best memories and their best moments, but also their best discussions, has been just packed into one of those services that the house needs to have. When did we lose the possibility of the bathroom becoming this ritualistic aspect of taking care of ourselves? Could we think that the bathroom then becomes this space where we could understand the possibility, the necessity of taking care of ourselves and others? This space, I think, could regain its ritualistic aspect of the understanding of the caring and the necessity of the relationship of ourselves and our bodies, and not become just a mere functional space that is manning us for the possibility of really relating with others in a very important and intimate way. The kitchen obviously is the most contested space of them all, and I believe that has several problematic aspects. And first, in the configuration as we know it, as the pre-described, preconceived house, and first of all, and the most important thing is that it obviously perpetuates the discrimination of the women. We do all have to eat. But why is that women need to cook for all of us? Obviously, we're trying to change that. And we hope that in a future, things become more equal and it's not only women. But at the end, if we don't change the social system where reproductive labor and reproductive and care labor is not paid, is not a recognized paid job, then someone is going to be discriminated by fact. If we keep the impossibility of sharing a space to produce the most important thing that we need to survive, which is food, and by sharing it, creating a social possibility of relationships, we will discriminate, we will continue to perpetuate the system of discrimination. And again, I declare myself guilty with this because I have done several houses that without questioning, I just put a kitchen and a bathroom and into rooms and living space. Also, the other aspect is that this configuration is pre-describing the way we eat, not only the way we socialize, the way we have to take care of us, but the way we eat as well. No, it's really incredibly crazy that everybody now imagine themselves in these living conditions. No, their dream house is this incredible space with an open kitchen to the living space that we can all in the family share and be there around. But if you think a little bit further, I mean, this space is banning the possibility of producing many types of food in the world, no? This kitchen would only allow to have something that is produced fast, that doesn't create a lot of smell, that doesn't produce a lot of mess, you know? And why are we banning the possibility and reducing the importance of the ritualistic aspect of eating and eating together, no? This is also kind of banning us for the possibility of creating other sets of relationships. And we understood this very well when we endeavor ourselves to work with for the reconstruction process in Mexico. We had in 2017 two very big earthquakes that turned down 500,000 homes, and we decided to act in a small town where 1,000 homes were destroyed, and we were able to help 50 families to rebuild their homes. We decided not to design. We decided just to be a kind of technical advisors, I would say, if I could put a name on it, and help these people to think how to rebuild their own spaces. We decided that they needed to continue with the tradition that they have been holding forever, that they build their own spaces, but with a new understanding. And here the problematic was deeper. I'm not going to go into it, but the problem of the lack of technical knowledge on the new materials that arrived with the recently signed NAFTA agreement 30 years ago, and the lack of a possibility of the communities to really create an understanding and a knowledge on the use of this material was the causing the problem of the fall. But the same is with its culture, no? If we try to impose the way we live into these communities, then we will ban the possibilities for them to really create a sustainable future, which is happening exactly with the materials, no? So we understand a kitchen to these people means completely different things, no? To start with, it's always a shared space. It never goes inside. This space produces a lot of different types of smells and fumes, etc. Why tuck it into a living space? They cannot really conceive this. But not only that, it's always a shared space. And what happened in cities? Why did we forget that this is an intrinsically hyper important part of our lives? That it also can allow us to open channels for a different possibility of relationships. Long ago, we also started already thinking on the kitchen as this space that needs to become a more free agent from the domestic realm. And we designed this house that I'm not going to tell the story. It's a design strategy for a house that it's modular, can be configured in different ways, and it's affordable. And in this case, what we wanted to do is to create the space of a kitchen that would allow us to, that would allow the inhabitant to decide whether they wanted the kitchen inside the living space or outside as a space to share, or as a possibility productive space, or as any possibility that, or maybe to transform it in another room for another family member, no? And we built the houses in some of them, and we definitely understood that every other person had a different necessity and transformed the kitchen into something completely different. This guy decided that he wanted to do this little store with some preparing area. This lady decided to open it to the family in order to share this space with the intimate family. And this is how we started thinking, no, on the possibility of constituting the kitchen as a space that needs definitely to have its own possibility and not become this closet prefix and preconceived closet in every space that we arrive to. Also, long ago, we were also challenging the notion of a kitchen that it needs to remain in one single space, and it needs to you know, be very interiorized in the home. But not only that, it needs to stay there when you move away as well. So we decided we were invited to exhibition that would allow us to that they asked us to think on the kitchen of the future. And we thought the kitchen of the future needed to be something that could become the space for cooking your own meal individually, for cooking for your own family, but also to reconfigure it when you need have other needs, but also move it and bring it to the living space or bring it to the terrace to cook in different ways, no? And we did this in this house, in Los Terrenos, in Monterrey, where we decided that the kitchen and this space, like kind of more the public space, needed to have a possibility of being interiorly and reconfigured interiorly, but also brought to the terrace exteriorly. And then what about the house? No, what about that possibility of the definition? Well, first of all, I think that we really need to understand that the domestic environment and the way we live is completely different from one from each other. No, from every human being thinks it lives differently, but we have really tried to fix it in a pre-standardized condition that in order to search for equality and democracy, we lost the possibility of including the diverse ways of living. And this is something that I also have questions for a long time. And we did this project in Spain that in the beginning, and that was my thought at that time in life, where they asked us for this house in a project called Solo Houses in Spain, where I never where we wouldn't have a client. I hate the word client, sorry, where we didn't knew who was going to inhabit this place. But and we needed to design a space for X who arrived. And I used to think that I designed not being the other, not for others being the other, no? So I needed a conversation, a dialogue, an immersion in their lives. And for me, this was almost impossible to do it without clients. But when we were put on this, we said, okay, well, maybe it's a correct moment to understand how to do a space for living for someone that you don't know, but still you want to do something for that someone you don't know. So how to create a platform for someone else to create their own life? And we said, well, first of all, let's try to think that we will not make a space functional, and we will not define the program of the space. So meaning we will not create a specific room that is larger for a double room, a specific bathroom, a specific room that it's called bathroom, where you pack the WC and the shower and the sink, a specific kitchen where you place the fixed furniture. We will just create a space with an important personality, because let's be honest, we cannot do something that doesn't come from our minds and from our own perspective. So let's be honest, do that, and not put labels on the space. So we created this series of modules that do not have a definition. They don't have a purpose. They just have an aesthetic, very strong characterization, no? So why did we do this amount of models? Because we wanted. Why did they have these shapes? Because we like this shape, because we think it's beautiful. And note how we think, no, is super subjective. And we decided to scatter those models around the landscape and to allow those models to stack or to expand or to open, and never directing what those models would be used by. Then we came with the problem that we needed to submit the plans for the municipality, and then we didn't want it even to represent that any of these modules were intended for any space and for any specific use at all. So we created these drawings that are all drawing sections, plans in ones, modules. It was approved, so I'm glad, although it hasn't been built. And in this way, we are imagining that this place can be inhabited in many, many different ways, no? Or for one person, or for a series of persons, or a couples, or not, or whatever configuration, many people in one of them, and then the rest empty, or the other way around. Every people inhabiting one space, and we don't know. No, so this was the first attempt to understand how to create a platform for anyone else to decide how to live. Then we were invited to another project in Germany called Lake Edersee, where the lake is called Lake Edersee. This is a small town around the lake, where we were asked to design a house for the new ways of life. And this was pre-COVID, this was 2017. The brief asked us to do a house for the supposedly new ways of life, which is working and living in the same space. We, at that time, I thought, well, this is not exactly the new ways of life. If there's a way of living in through the history of humanity, is working and living in the same space, but of the last 150 years, probably 200, we're in only in cities, because in the rest of the rural areas and more non-urban environments still happens, where we live and work in separate spaces, no? So for me, it was more thinking how we could do a space for the ways of life for anyone, no? For all those different ways of lives, and or to open the possibility for anyone to do that. So we, in this case, we decided to create a totally different process of design. We started with this chart, thinking on which activities we wanted to promote in the space. So we know that space is direct activity. So I was saying, if you do a room that is larger and one that is smaller, it's absolutely saying that one is accepting a couple or one or more people, and the other one is for smaller people, children, or less people, no? So as we know that, we wanted, instead of promoting activities or emotions, instead of directing amounts of people or uses or anything. So we chose six spaces, and we defined them through collages. I'm not going to go why into the collage, but this is the first project where collages was used as a tool of design, and proved very interesting and very, very, very successful. And when we decided these six spaces that define the house, we knew that they were six. Why six? Because in the brief, they asked us a room, two rooms, and a bathroom, and a kitchen, and a living space, and there were six. So we decided to do those six, but without those etiquettes, and just spaces that would promote different types of relationship because of their proportions, because of their relationship towards the context, because it's towards its position. So this is how we define those spaces. And then we collaged those six spaces, and we arrived here. We said, now what? We traced them, and we started the process of design. At that time, I thought that we presented this project. We thought it was kind of an hypothetical project. We thought, my reflection with it was, well, we probably could have arrived to the same solution, to the same proposal, to the same physical manifestation of our idea with the same formula that you always start, no? Do two bathrooms, two bedrooms, one bathroom and a kitchen, and we would have probably designed the same. That was my idea. But a year ago, someone arrived that wanted to build this house, and we had started the process. We started the process of design, or really truly designing. It was only a conceptual. It was only a conceptual proposal, and we understood that we really opened the possibilities to these people. The house is going to start construction in a month, and the persons who are going to inhabit it decided to define the spaces in a completely different way of what I would think that I would inhabit this house. And that was exactly the proof that we really were doing a different process for a different possibility, no? So it was not that we could have done the same. I think that this possibility needs to open channels, not only for the interiority of the house, but also to create a more a different possible relationship with the other, no, in a collective realm. So obviously it's too easy to speak on these things when you have an idyllic context, in the case of the two last houses. But we have also used these strategies in completely different contexts, no, as well as incredibly affordable ones. So a house that is defined by different modules, that these modules can be used for as anyone decides has to use them, around a patio that with among these totally different configurations then allow to the possibilities of relationship to the others to form spaces that can become those spaces where the community interacts and has the potentiality of having whatever they want. If they want to share a kitchen, but some probably maybe they don't want to share a kitchen, they need a space to take care of the children, to take care of the elderly. I don't know, a space that the community itself would be able to define, no, and to decide then how to do it. How or what happens then in a more dense environment? We are also trying to think that we could bring forward those ideas. And we are now in the process, and sorry that I'm saying only these projects that are in process, because as I said, this is something that has happened in a transformation in our office in the last 4 years or so. But this project in Monterrey, it's a project where we really thought it was hyper important to break the specific configuration of the developer, 164 apartments, no, that thinks that it's doing a community, because that's why they hire us. And we said, well, with 164 apartments and the configuration of a communal space of amenities with a pool and in a playground and these things, you are not creating a community. So we decided to challenge the configuration and understanding that we needed to have these scales of relationships of different households in a more specific way. So what we did is we created kind of these bubbles of four apartments, six apartments, where they share a garden, an edible garden, or a barbecue area, or a terrace, or a room for a social room that they it can be defined by the community. And then these 20 apartments or four apartments relate to each other with a stair that only takes them to the specific place. This building is already under construction. And we're really aiming for this possibility of creating a more a possibility for spaces that we'd allow. We don't know if they will happen, that we'd allow for this interaction to happen more closely than just the dichotomy of your private space and the public collective space. And we have really gone as far as questioning this relationship, no, towards I started from the small domestic realm towards the more collective world. So what happens in the city, no? And this is something that we have also started to explore, how to challenge the typology of the vertical realm. We think that right now the skyscraper bans the possibility of the relationship with the city. No, it's a suburb immersed in the middle of the city, because when you arrive, you enter a completely different world. You get into this capsule that brings you high. Yeah, you can oversee the city, but you cannot completely relate to it. No, so we have created this proposal that obviously is still a very conceptual one, but it's prompting us with ideas to think how to bring that possibility of organic or more organic development of the city that happens in continuous without anyone directing it in the city, in the vertical realm. No, so how can we really think that it's not only thought and done and developed one by one single entity, which that exactly what is doing is banning the possibility of representation for everybody, for it's also banning the possibility of accepting diversity, and it's also banning the possibility of the experience of the city. No, so how to bring that into the vertical realm? How can a vertical structure be developed by different entities in different periods of time? I know there are a lot of challenges. I'm not so naive. I know there's gravity to start, there's economics to go, and all of the other things. But I think it's important to understand how to challenge that possibility and understand that we also don't need to still work, you know, with those prescribed precepts, which are really not allowing these other possibilities to happen, no? And I think that in the moment when we are able to create this stage relationship, then we are able to, if we understand the neighbor behind next to us, then we understand the possibility of relating to our own small community of 5-6 in households. And then we understand the possibility of how to relate to the 164. And then we understand the possibility of relating, no, with the collective at large. And again, stop living with this dichotomy of the public and the private, which right now in the cities is how we live. No, we open our door and the next immediate thing that we have in collective environments is a space that is a space that it's either needs a commercial negotiation or an institutional relationship. Either the commercial or the institution is the one that is regulating that space, and then it becomes this relationship becomes incredibly abstract, and banning the possibility of these more social relationships. I believe truly that by the understanding that by the staging of the understanding of our relationship within us, we are going to be able to then extend this possibility of relationship to the environment where we live in. And we've been working for the last 20, no, not yet, to the last 16 years in this botanical garden in Culiacán, where we have understood how important, no, those relationships that are being built through this in this garden, not because of us, because the garden existed 35 years ago, are really creating the sense of identity towards the city, no, and the possibility of identification of the city, of representation of a huge range of people that really come together here, no, and also for me, the 16 years and the building the relationship in this garden has allowed me to understand, no, the real necessity of us of also not dichotomizing our relationship with nature. I think that we are now in this place where we think we dominate nature or that nature dominates us. Well, I think we are nature. We cannot speak on those terms. We are part of it. And we are part of this virtuous or vicious circle, depending how we position ourselves. And we haven't been able as society to put ourselves in it, within it, to be able to protect it. And I think that this is instrumental, and this could be achieved by this series of scaled relationships. No, it's impossible to understand how you're going to make harm into the environment by using one plastic bag. But when you see a turtle eating a plastic bag, you will not use a plastic bag ever again in your life. Well, this is how relationships, I think, need to be staged and not left to this complete abstract a hugeness of the "a bag will save the world," you know? And this garden has allowed us to do that, as well as has allowed us to, has given us the possibility of building other projects nearby. And I'm just going to end this talk by explaining very quickly the last project that we're working, because I think that then creates a new possibility of reflection. No, we were invited because of the botanical garden to design a garden in the middle of a park, a huge park, in the middle of a city called Mazatlan, where we spent 4 years designing this social, cultural, environmental space that has a regulating lagoon that comes up and down through the year, depending on the season. And when we started doing the project, doing the reconfiguration of the lagoon, the reconstitution, the cleaning of the lagoon, then they asked us to do an aquarium. And for me, the aquarium was the ultimate, most problematic programs of all, because this is the place where, for me, is the perfect description of what Diego Rivera did in this mural, man controller of the universe. No, it's a world that we cannot enter, so why don't we bring it to us in order to fantasy with it? No, so for me, it was a bit problematic, especially that you have here, Mazatlan has is the door of the most one of the most interesting natural aquariums of the world, which is the Sea of Cortes, and why bring it into a building? No, so then when I told them this, they said, "Well, we do have the most important aquarium in the world, and we need to have a link with it towards society to understand the necessity of protecting it." So then things transformed, and I said, "Okay, why don't then we make a space that was invaded by nature, that nature took over, and we arrived to just open the paths for people to realize that nature, we are nature and we are part of it, no?" So we created a path within this ruin that existed in 2020. In 2100, it was flooded with water. And 2200, the water receded, and then life was able to happen there. No? And so we created this space where we digged in, and we allowed people to enter and discover this life that grew there. No? And right now, this building is being built. The ruin is being built. Let's see when we arrive in 200, 2000, what happens. Thank you very much.